The Byford Dolphin accident is one of the most horrific accidents in recent human history. The four divers who were inside the decompression chamber that fateful day, British men Edwin Coward and Roy Lucas, alongside Norwegians Bjørn Bergesen and Truls Helvik, could not even comprehend their horrifying ordeal, as the initial blast would have killed them in a fraction of a second. This is the Byford Dolphin accident. Put yourself in the following situation. You just scored yourself a job that pays $30,000 up to $45,000 per month, but you work 100 meters beneath the sea, a place as strange to sunlight, where temperatures can plunge to freezing conditions. All of the hours you do have off are spent in a small confined metal tube. In this metal tube, there is basically only two things you can do to pass the time. You may choose to eat, or you may choose to catch a few hours of sleep before your next 8 to 10 hour shift begins. Then it's time once again to dive back into the abyss. Visualize yourself living like this for months at a time. Welcome to the strange world of saturation diving, one of the world's most dangerous and well-paying jobs. In 1969, a humanitarian ship called the Ocean Viking stumbled upon one of the largest oil pockets in the world. Hoping to capitalize on this find, the Norwegians began extracting 1.6 million barrels of crude oil a day. This was the driving force in the economy we can see today. Prior to this, in the 1960s, the Norwegian economy was what you could call underwhelming. Simply put, the country was quite poor, with its economy based mainly on fishing, the export of wood, and hydroelectric power. One of the most important gas pockets in Norway is located in Frigg. Frigg is a field in the central part of the North Sea, straddling the border between the UK and Norwegian sectors, with the waters having a depth of around 330 feet. To extract the gas, the government hired BP, or British Petroleum, an oil and gas company, headquartered in London, England, who in turn contracted a company called Dolphin Drilling, an offshore drilling rig company, headquartered in Aberdeen, Scotland. The engineers of Dolphin Drilling were faced with the intimidating task of how to safely extract the oil, since the distance from the surface to the sea floor is 328 feet and the gas pocket is located 6,070 feet below the water. The solution, a semi-submergible stabilized column drilling rig. They called it Byford Dolphin. Weighing 3,000 tons and manned by a crew of 100, it was capable of drilling in waters up to 1,510 feet in depth. It was equipped with advanced drilling equipment and could maneuver with its own engines. To allow construction and maintenance of the wellhead at these depths, the rig was also equipped with a sophisticated saturation diving system built by French firm Comex. Of the 100 crew members, 6 were divers, accompanied by 2 dive tenders. Dive tenders tend to the needs and wants of commercial divers. The divers were tasked with the repairs and maintenance of the submerged section of the platform, as well as the drill and extractors when they were in operation. A job more complex than most can imagine. Apart from being excellent welders and mechanics, the divers worked in very extreme conditions due to the depth at which they operate. On Saturday, the 5th of November, 1983, at 4 a.m, while drilling in the Frigg Sea gas field in the Norwegian sector of the North Sea, 2 of the divers, Bjørn Bergesen and Truls Helvik, were on the ocean floor working on an oil well when the team was told that bad weather was amidst. Bergesen and Helvik then proceeded into the diving bell that would pull them up to the decompression chambers. The bell was then raised to the surface and clamped to a walkway called the deck, which led to the chambers. Bergesen and Helvik set their wet gear on the deck and entered chamber 1. Coward and Lucas were resting in the second chamber at the time. The usual steps of this procedure was intended to follow this order. First, close the door of the diving bell. Second, a supervisor will slightly increase the bell's pressure to make sure it seals tightly. Third, close the door that connects the deck and the diving chamber. 4. Slowly depressurize the deck. And the fifth and final step, separate the bell from the chamber system. The first two steps occurred with no issues, but for some reason unbeknownst to the crew, Crammond released the clamp before Helvig closed the door to the chamber. This caused an explosive decompression from a pressure of 9 atmospheres to 1 atmosphere. Air rushed out of the chamber with tremendous force, jamming the interior deck door and pushing the bell away. Crammond was killed, while the other dive tender, Mr. Saunders, was severely injured. All 4 divers were killed from the explosive decompression instantly. Helvig was in the process of securing the inner door when he was sucked through the 24-inch diameter opening of the jam door, causing him to be violently dismembered. His abdominal section was split and his organs were ejected from his body, except for his trachea, a section of the small intestine, and the section of the spine. His insides exploded all over the area, one section later being found 30 feet further vertically above the exterior pressure door. During forensic investigations of all the divers, large amounts of fats were found in their arteries, veins, and organs. It was found that the rapid change of pressure was so strong that it caused the divers' fat to separate from their blood. It is still not known why Crammond released the clamp too soon. The community in charge of investigating the situation had 2 conclusions on the cause of the accident. One being human error. At the time, the only communication the tenders on the outside of the chamber system had was through a bullhorn attached to the wall surface, with heavy noise added from the rig and sea. The men also worked very long hours during those times, sometimes up to 16-hour shifts, which caused a lot of fatigue. The other cause was concluded to be the company's failure to build a safe hatch into the rig system. If fail mechanisms were present, the crew may have been spared their fate. Built in 1975, the Byford Dolphin was not equipped with fail-safe hatches, outward pressure gauges, or an interlocking mechanism which would have prevented the deck from being opened while the system was under pressure. The North Sea Divers Alliance, formed by early North Sea divers and relatives of those killed, continued to press for further investigation and, in February 2008, obtained a report that indicated the real cause was faulty equipment. Initially, families were told that the blast was an accident caused by air escaping from the diving bell because gauges had been tampered with. Claire Lucas, daughter of Roy Lucas, said, "I would go so far as to say that the Norwegian government murdered my father because they knew they were diving with an unsafe decompression chamber." The families of the divers eventually received compensation for the damages from the Norwegian government 26 years after the incident. The Byford Dolphin rig is still in operation, currently on contract with British Petroleum, and saturation diving continues to be widely used in the offshore oil industry, consistently ranking among the most dangerous but well-paid jobs in the world, with many divers receiving up to $1,400 per day. While safety measures and accident rates have improved significantly since 1983, the Byford Dolphin incident stands as a bitter reminder of the dangers that always come with living and working in extreme environments, more specifically, saturation diving. Thank you for watching. This has been Gripping Horror, and I hope to see you in the next one.